We have Priyam Patel, who's going to tell us about the inquiries on services by three manifolds and the curved wrap.
Thank you. Thanks for everyone for coming, and thank you to the organizers for having me. Okay, so I'm going to start out with S is a closed surface. So a lot of the things I'll talk about today are going to work with the punctured case, but I'll just stick to this for today. And I'm going to define the curved complex because there are some grad students here, or I'll just say it. So this is going to be the curved complex. It's a few words I'll write down. The vertices are isotopic classes of simple closed curves, and you attach to vertices by an edge if the isotopic classes admit disjoint representatives on the surface. And that's a curved graph, and if you fill in an N simplex anytime you see it's one skeleton, then you get the curved complex. So it's really important. A lot of people in this room have worked a lot on the curved complex, and it tells you a lot about the large scale geometry of the surface. So maybe the next thing I'll tell you is that if you have P, a degree K cover, of your surface, then there exists a coarsely well-defined induced map on the level of curved complexes. Okay, so then there exists an induced map, which I will call P upper star, okay, from the curved complex of S to the curved complex of the cover, S prime. Okay, where, how do you define this? Well, P star of gamma, and also I'm going to just blur the distinction constantly between an isotopy class, a curve, and then also I'm going to try to be careful about when I start talking about three manifolds, it's geodesic representative in the three manifold, but if I drop a notation, then hopefully the context will be enough for you to gather what's going on. Okay, so this is a simplex defined by the inverse image of your curve on your surface. So this is in the curve complex of the upstate surface. Okay, so you have a curve, you look at its full preimage, that defines simplex, and that's your map. So, of course, we can consider these curve complexes as metric spaces by putting the graph metric on them. And so, what I'm going to do is say that, let's say ds and ds prime are metrics on these curve complexes. And the way that I'm going to define the distance of the images of classes under this map, okay, this is going to be defined to be the diameter of P star alpha union P star beta in the upstairs curve complex. Okay? So the first theorem that I'll start out with, kind of low. Okay, let me know if you can't see anymore. Okay, this is a Khosra, Rafi, and Salzheimer from 2009. Okay, what they showed is that this map is a C quasi isometric embedding. So P star. The curve complex of S to the curve complex of S prime is a C quasi-isometric embedding. Where the quasi-constant, I'm going to be a total mess from jet lag, but the quasi-constant C is depending on the Euler characteristic of S and the degree of the cover. Okay, so where C depends on the characteristics of S and the degree of cover. Okay, so what does this theorem say? Maybe the first thing I'll note is that distances don't increase under this map. So the distance in the curved complex of the upstairs surface is definitely less than or equal to the distance in S between alpha and beta. Okay? That's because things as they lift become more and more distant. Okay, but what the theorem says is that the other part is the interesting part, which is that curves don't detangle that much in small finite degree covers. Okay, so the theorem says. Curves don't detangle much in small degree covers. Okay, so maybe I'll pose a question. So let's say you start out with two simple closed curves. So take alpha and beta, two simple closed curves. They intersect a lot, and maybe my question is, can we give a lower bound on the degree of a cover S primed where there's a lift of each of these curves and they're disjoint? Okay, so that there exists lifts of alpha and beta that are disjoint. Okay, so that's like some sort of question you can ask about curves on surfaces. So I care a lot about like these sort of lifting questions. There's an application I have in mind for this question that I probably won't get to tell you about because the topic is too short. But I can tell you about it later. It's about dual complexes to a system of curves on surfaces. So can you find a lower bound on this? So this is obviously related to effectivizing the Rothe-Schleimer result. Okay, so the related question is, can we effectivize or quantify the theorem that I wrote? So I won't leave you in suspense for too long. And the answer is yes. Okay. That's part of what we'll talk about today. So this is my work with Tariq Al-Gav, myself, and Sam Taylor. I won't put a date on it because we still have to post it to the archive. It'll happen soon. Okay. So maybe what I'll say is that there are a couple of constants, A1 and A2. So that we can get this, the lower bound here, right? So this is bounded from above. Okay, well, let me tell you about the constants. So A1, okay, so where A1 is on the order of Euler characteristic of S to the 7th, A2 is on the order of Euler characteristic of S squared, and maybe I'll write times k, or so I'll say this is linear in the degree of the cover. Okay, so it's on the order of Euler characteristic of S squared times k. Okay, so that's telling you exactly what the quasi constant, how it depends polynomially on the Euler characteristic and linearly on the degree of the cover. Okay, so how do we go about this? Well, we actually use a different approach. So there's a theorem of Robert Tang's from 2012, using the work of Bowditch, which reproves, so I won't tell you exactly what's going on here, besides reproves the Rothe-Schleimer theorem using three manifolds and electric metrics. And I'll get into more about that in just a little while. Okay? So, maybe just one bit of notation before I state, oh, and this is supposed to be labeled theorem one. Okay, so just a bit of notation. I'm not going to go into details about this, but there's going to be some carefully chosen constant throughout the talk that you're going to see. So there exists a carefully chosen constant, which I'll call epsilon s, okay, which is on the order of 1 over the characteristic of S. And the second piece of information that's relevant is that it's smaller than the three-dimensional Margulis constant. you what that is in a second too. Okay. So I'll tell you the theorem that we prove that helps us prove theorem one. So there's going to be some notation that shows up to this theorem, and then I'll explain all of it in just a bit. So, okay, so let's let alpha and beta. Sam.
Sam.
Sam. I can't like call people. Sometimes I have a hard time calling people by their last names when they're like friends. Okay. Sorry, Sam. For me, it's the same because I have the same initial. But. Okay, so let's let alpha and beta be simple closed curves, of course. And I'm going to let M be surface cross R hyperbolic premanifold. Okay, and let's assume that the curves are short on on that three-manifold. So the length measured in M of the geodesic representatives is less or equal to this magic constant, epsilon S, okay? So then, what we can show is that in the electrified metric, where we're electrifying the thin part, again, I'll tell you what that is in just a second, I just want to make sure I write this down. This is bounded from below by 1 over A1 of S times the distance between alpha and beta, and it's bounded from above by the constant A2 times the distance in the curve complex. Okay, where these alpha bar, beta bars, these are the geodesic representatives of alpha and beta and M. And again, the constants I won't rewrite. They're on the order of, or the characteristic to the seventh and squared. And this metric is electrifying the thin parts, okay, is obtained from M by electrifying okay, so I'm going to unpack this for a bit, but maybe one thing I'll note is that the upper bound on the length is not necessary for the second inequality. Okay, that'll come up later, so note length bound not necessary for the upper bound. When I show you how to get theorem 1 from theorem 2, that'll become relevant. Okay, so let's just unpack this for a little bit. So unpacking theorem 2. So let's see. The first thing I want to tell you, a lot of people know this already, of course, but you can decompose a hyperbolic free manifold. So let's fix delta greater than 0. Okay, you decompose a hyperbolic free manifold into its thin and thick part. Okay, where x is in the thin part if the injectivity radius at x is less than delta. Okay, so why do we choose this constant to be less than the three-dimensional Margulis constant? Well, there exists this constant, and when you know that if delta is less than that three-dimensional constant, then you can completely tell what the thin parts look like. Okay, so when this is less than the three-dimensional Margulis constant, the thin part, the delta thin part, consists of cusps. Okay, looking like this, and disjoint Margulis tubes. So what are Margulis tubes? They're solid tori around short curves in your three-manifold. Okay, so it's like the generalization of like the collar neighborhood. work hard on surface. And we don't have to worry about cusps because I took my surface to be closed. Okay, so we'll just be thinking about destroying margulous tubes for today. Okay, so just in case you haven't seen this before, what does it mean to, so this is, maybe I won't, okay, maybe I will write it down. So electrifying the metric, the epsilon s thin part of the surface. So electrifying the epsilon s thin part means that it costs nothing to go through the thin part. Maybe you have a geodesic you're going to care about, which we will later on in the talk, and it goes, you know, through tubes, and you can't really control how long it's in the tubes. Well, when you electrify, that doesn't matter. It just doesn't cost anything to go through. Okay, any questions before I tell you how to get theorem one from theorem two? Okay. These are really good. I was wondering how I was going to do this until I saw someone pull on the string. Okay, so theorem two implies theorem one. Okay, so to start out with, I'm going to fix alpha and beta. And I'm going to let Q be a quasi-Fuchsian free manifold where the lengths of these curves on the conformal boundary are going to be short enough. So the length of alpha is less than or equal to epsilon s over 2. The length on the other conformal boundary of beta is less than or equal to epsilon s over 2. So the theorem of Bayes tells you you can always find something like this. And that's just going to make sure that my curves are short enough on the three manifold so I can apply my theorem. Okay, so this means, maybe I'll just write this out, the length and Q of alpha beta. Less than or equal to epsilon s. Okay, so apply theorem 2. And what do you get? I'm going to apply the upper bound here. So the distance in the curve complex is bounded from above by a1 of s times the distance in Q electrified between the geodesic representatives of O, and I'm dropping things like that. Great. Okay. Okay, so that's what we first do. The second ingredient is then that you look at, so remember that we have this covering map on the level of surfaces, right? This is a degree K cover. That's going to induce a covering map on the level of three manifolds. Okay, so this gives you, I'll call it P lower star from P star Q to Q, okay, where this cover is still a quasi-Fuchsian three manifold, and it's going to be an S prime cross R. Quasi-Fuchsian three manifold. Okay, so given two pieces of information, first, covering maps are distance non-increasing maps, okay? The second thing, so maybe I won't write that down. The second thing is that you're looking, I basically want to say something about this distance and the distance in the cover, and say that now I can replace this with the distance in the upstairs surface, okay? In the upstairs three maps. And for that, you also need to know that the thin parts go to the thin parts, okay? So once you have those two pieces, that covering maps are not increasing and thin parts go to thin parts, what this tells you is that the distance here between the geodesic representative of alpha and beta is less than or equal to the electrified distance between, what's my notation, P star of alpha, P star of beta. So let me tell you what those are and how I'm measuring distance. So this, where this is the geodesic representative of, well, maybe I said geodesic representatives of P inverse of alpha. So you have a bunch of connected components in the inverse image. and you take all their geodesic representatives. And the way that I'm going to measure distance, so this is measured, is defined to be the minimal electric distance between any tube about a component of the free image of alpha, well, any component of this and any component of this. So this is the minimal electric distance between a tube about a curve in this and a tube, any tube, about a curve in so now we're going to apply the theorem again. And this is why it's relevant that we don't need the length bound, because we've gone to a cover. So now we do apply theorem two.
So can you explain the notation again? So dp star q, and then you have epsilon s,
yeah.
S prime?
So I'm lifting the metric, and then I'm electrifying the thin part in that three.
But did epsilon s not be the one on the cover? Epsilon s prime, which one?
Oh, it's still epsilon s. That's important. Yeah, don't change it. And what the comment that I made was, you're still fine, because you're not going to use that length bound in the second inequality. So when I apply the next thing, it's okay that I'm still using epsilon s and not epsilon s prime or something like that. Okay. so now we apply theorem two again, and we have that this distance now. Is bounded from above by a 2 times the distance in the new curve complex between p star alpha and p star beta. Okay, so, and maybe I should be careful here. This is a 2 of s prime. Okay, so a 2 of s prime, so a 2 is on the order of actually Euler characteristic of s times Euler characteristic of s prime, and what you get is then Euler characteristic of s squared times k, okay, because that's what this is. That's where that degree factor comes in. Okay, so combining all of that, you get the theorem, right? There's theorem one, which I wrote here somewhere. Okay, move everything over to one side, and you got it. Okay? So, wow, I have a lot more time than I thought I would. I gave this talk to like grad students 3 days ago, so it's totally different with this audience. I have to define many things. Are there any questions before I kind of tell you some of the ingredients that go into proving theorem two?
Just to clarify, are you electrifying the cusps?
We're not dealing with cusps because we have closed surface, but in the cusp case, yeah, we do. Yeah, right? Yes. Yeah. You do the
correct
thing.
Maybe
we should talk about that after. I don't want to get into that. Yeah. Okay. We can talk about that.
You be careful.
You be careful. That's the answer from Sam. S. Okay.
Where does the half come from? The length and the
boundary. This is theorem of, do we say it's alphors or bears?
Bears.
It's bears. So if they're there's a factor of two that comes up. So if they're epsilon s over two short, I don't know exactly where it comes from, though, like why there's a factor of two.
It goes through complex, and it goes through a modulus computation. You have annualized infinity together to make a torus.
Okay.
That's the factor of two.
That's a factor of two. Okay.
Sorry, what do you mean for pressure plus q?
What's that?
Pressure plus q.
Oh, I didn't tell you what that is. Okay, sorry. So that's if you know about quasi-Fuchsian three manifolds, which it's okay if you don't. But for a quasi-Fuchsian three manifold, there's two boundaries, like sort of at infinity. And on one, you choose alpha to be short. On the other one, you choose beta to be short. But I'd have to talk to you for a lot longer about that to really get you to understand properly. So I'm going to just defer to say, it's okay if you don't get that part. The point is that you can choose a three manifold where your curves are short. That's the whole point. Okay, short enough. Okay, so let me tell you about the tools for theorem two. So one of the bounds is not actually too difficult. So for the so for this inequality, the upper bound, so alpha bar, beta bar, is going from above by E2 and S. So this is the easier way. And maybe I won't write this out, but basically you use a fact about pleated surfaces and free manifolds. You use something about the electric diameter of any hyperbolic structure on the surface S, and some hyperbolic geometry. Okay, I'll write out the second part is the harder part, and I'll tell you actually sort of a sketch of what goes on there. Okay. So for the second part, so the other way, so bounding this part. Okay, so I was gonna switch up the order in which I did this. So I will try to do that in live time. So let's first consider a geodesic, which I have to call G because I already used P for covering maps. All other good letters were taken. So I know it's a group element, but you can, it's also geodesic, because it's G. So consider a geodesic G between alpha bar and beta bar. Okay, and of course we're talking about electric distance, and so the time that G spends in the tubes is not going to matter. It's the time in between the tubes that we really have to measure. Okay, so let's let this set gamma I from I equals 0 to m be the sequence of geodesics in the free manifold. such that G meets the tube, the epsilon S tube around gamma I. Okay, and in that order, let's say. In that order. So there's a couple of things I should note. So for the first thing is that since we chose our curves to be short enough, and the geodesic is starting at alpha bar and ending at beta bar, so the first thing is that gamma naught is alpha bar, and the ending point is beta bar. Okay, and there's actually finitely many along the way. So, and maybe I'll say the distance, there is actual distance, I'll say. There is this distance between epsilon S2s. Okay, so since there's some definite distance between the epsilon S tubes, you know that there can only be finitely many of them. And actually, at another part in the paper, we actually use what that distance is, and the exact calculation is due to Dave Huter, Jessica Purcell, and Saul, and they're also working on finishing this paper. Okay, so this is the effectivization of that. So how much do we actually have between epsilon S tubes, depending on how much smaller epsilon S is than the Mertens constant. Okay, so,
What can you say about the gamma I's?
They're short curves where those are the tubes that G is meeting as it treks out between alpha and beta. Yeah. Okay, so again, I don't care about what the geodesic is doing within the tubes, but the distance between the tubes we have to somehow understand. Okay, the time that the geodesic spends in between them. Okay, so I'll start with what's called a sweep out, which is maps from, this is different hyperbolic structures on S into your free manifold. Okay, these are one Lipschitz maps.
I don't use G.
Oh no, wait. Oh.
Well,
so she's using T.
Yeah.
It's okay. It's okay, right? Okay, I'm not gonna use it anyway. Let's just change it, because now it's bothering me. So there we go. Did I use H anywhere else? No, I don't think so. Okay, so this is a sweep out of one Lipschitz map through one Lipschitz maps. And there's a construction, there's a couple of people I could quote for a construction of such a thing. But I guess the idea is sort of that you like look at your geodesic here and your geodesic here. Okay, maybe they're in that order. And your seatbelt starts over here and ends over here, and it can do a bunch of stuff in between. Okay, but it's a bunch of maps of your surface, one Lipschitz maps of your surface into the three manifold. Okay, and then, I'm being vague here, by the way. The rest of it's gonna be a little bit vague, just to give you an idea of what's happening. But this can be really badly behaved, the sweep out. So what you do is we find a very good sub-sweep out, which I won't tell you exactly what that means. If you want the details of that, I can tell you later. And you can prove that when there exists, and prove that when there exists a good sweep out between the I'm saying this like in a very vague way, but let me just write it down and then I'll tell you what I mean. Okay, so when there exists a very good sweep out between the gamma I and gamma I plus I, or gamma I and gamma I plus one curves, yeah, that doesn't really make sense, but the point is this, that you look at your sort of, your whole sweep out, and you have some tube here around gamma I, and you hit your next tube around gamma I plus one, and between those two, you want like some really nice subsweep out. Okay, between those, when between, maybe I, oh, I was going to use the subscript GI, so it's good that I changed it. But basically there's some segment of, so the geodesic does whatever it does, okay, this is G. And then there's some segment between the two tubes, and you find some really good subsweep out between those two tubes in some sense. Okay, so there's a subsweep out, and what you can prove is that when there is such a good subsweep out, you can do the right distance bound. So the distance in the curve complex between gamma I and gamma I plus 1 is bounded from above by d times Euler characteristic of s to the 7th times the length of the GI curve, okay, which is actually the length, the electric length of this curve, because this is in the thick part. Okay, and then I piece this together. So piecing that together, right, so that the distance between alpha and beta is the sum of these distances between gamma I and gamma I plus 1. And that now is less than or equal to d times the Euler characteristic of this s to the 7th times the electric length of the geodesic. Okay, and obviously I'm leaving out a bunch of details. I'm not even telling you where the inequality comes from. Which I would say is for the sake of time, but actually I just didn't write it down. I didn't realize I had this much time. But that's okay. So I think I shouldn't give many more details than that because it's a little bit technical already. But the hard part, there's several hard parts here. They're sketched out sort of. Finding that very good subsweep out is part of the difficulty, and then controlling, you know, exactly what the bounds are once you have that very good subsweep out. So making sure that inequality is to like polynomial in S, in the Euler characteristic of S, and so on. Okay, but one thing that's good is I'm going to get back to the original question, and this will be my finishing word too. So remember the original question. Where did I write it? All the way up here. So here. So take alpha and beta, two simple closed curves on S. So can we give a lower bound on the degree? Well, yeah. Now we've effectivized this result. So let's just go back to that application really quickly, and then maybe in words I'll tell you what's going on in the cube complex land since I have a little bit of time. But the application here is that, so note that if the distance in the upstairs curve complex between the two lifts of your curves, right, if this is greater than or equal to 4, then every lift of alpha must intersect every lift of beta. Okay, so then every lift of alpha must intersect every lift of beta. Okay, so what does that mean? So, if we want a cover of, let's say, degree k, where there exists these sort of, you know, there exist these lifts and they're disjoint. Jeez. Then what do we know? So first let me just write down from the theorem, what you know is that 1 over a1 times a2 times the distance in this curve complex is less than or equal to the distance in this curve complex. And the thing here is that this has to be, in order for there to be a length of one that's disjoint from a length of the other, that has to be less than or equal to 3. Okay, so now you just solve for k here. So remember that this is like 1 over, there's some other constants, obviously. When I do this squiggly thing, that's because there's some universal constants floating around. But this is like Euler characteristic of s to the 9th times the degree of the cover, k. Okay, so that's less than or equal to 3. Okay, now you solve for k. And that's how you, there's a distance in the curve complex here, obviously. Okay, this is less than or equal to 3. Does anybody want me to solve for k? Okay, I'm not going to solve for k. So that gives you the lower bound that's in terms of the Euler characteristic of the surface and the distance downstairs in the original curve complex. Okay, so I'll just take a few more minutes because then we get to go to lunch too. The idea for the application is that I'll say it in words, and it's okay if you don't get any of this, but the idea is that if you take two curves on a surface and they together fill the surface, you look at the dual cube complex associated to that system, Segeek's construction. And here I want to say, can we bound, there's a finite degree cover of that which is definitely special, meaning its fundamental group embeds in a right-angled Artin group. And I want to say, could we somehow get a lower bound on the degree of that special cover? So it turns out that this sort of every lift of alpha must intersect every other lift of beta, that's actually telling you that the right-angled Artin group you would embed in is going to be a product of free groups, right? And surface groups can't go into that, like an actual product of free groups. Okay, so surface groups can't go into that. So in some sense, this is actually telling you an obstruction to specialness. And so again, you can say something like, there's a lower bound on specialness that looks something like this. Okay, so that's the sort of application that we had in mind for separating the curves. And if you want to hear more about that, I can also tell you at another time. I'm gonna stop.
7 is intriguing. Is it possible to explain to a non-expert why is a 7 there, or is that just like not sharp and it's just convenient?
Yeah, it's as good as we can get with an easy-ish argument that's still polynomial in the Euler characteristic. So I don't know if that can be made smaller, for instance, but
Everything's a bit legal. You have leading coefficients and all also.
Oh yeah, so anytime I'm saying that squiggle, it's because there's some universal constants out front that don't depend on anything.
Do you have any guess what k should be in terms of like a better bound we have in expectation?
So one thing I'll say is that the upper bound for this, for getting a cover where there's a disjoint lift from one to the other, it's something like intersection number plus 1 or something like that. So I think something that would be interesting is getting this bound in terms of intersection number, because I guess there are curves where the curve complex distance is approximately log of the intersection number. You can come up with examples. So there's some gap there. There's like a lower bound that's like log, and then the upper bound is like linear in the intersection number So I don't know if that's optimal, and it could be made better, maybe. So that's a good question to answer, maybe. Like, can you find a better lower bound in general for this question of lifting one to be disjoint from the other? And the upper bound is actually not that difficult to prove. It's just a counting intersections problem, which I can show you.
Any other questions? Okay, before we thank Pia,
we have an announcement. Okay, yes. Jay and myself and Anya and Julia Bavard are running an AIM workshop April 29th to May 3rd of next year on Big Mapping Class Groups. So that's my advertisement. So grad students should apply, right? Or anybody can apply. I don't know the rules.